Would you please turn in your Bibles with me to the book of 2 Timothy, 2 Timothy in chapter 2. Very fitting clip that we've just watched there. As we've now come to the home stretch, we are on the home stretch now of Engage 2016. And the focus of the second to last session that we have here together is persevering in wisdom. It's pressing forward through the trials and the difficulties that are ahead. The thing I love about that clip that we just watched is that it's so much what's needed for us as Christians, as Christian parents, as believers who really want to press forward in the things that are before us. And so oftentimes what can happen is that we're doing it with our eyes open instead of a blindfold on, trusting God. Our eyes are open and we're seeing the things in front of us, and they cause us to shrink back and hinder what it is that God wants to do. But something about that clip I think is very fitting. And as you know, in coming to a conference like Engage, like we are here at the moment, what's happened last night and throughout today is that we've been confronted with a number of good reminders of what it means to walk in the wisdom of God. Have we not? And yet the thing is that, and you and I both know that when we leave here after being reminded of what it means to walk in the wisdom of God, we know all too well the trials and the difficulties that are going to come our way. On one hand, we have a desire, and that desire is to see God's best being worked out in our lives and in the lives of our children as we seek to be disciples who then go and make disciples. But as we're going to do this, and as we've been encouraged this last weekend to go and do, there are going to be things in life that are going to hinder us, that are going to discourage us from really going and really pressing forward in the wisdom of God and in the things that we have been talking about and being reminded of this weekend. And I'm not talking just about the heavy duty trials, although I'm sure those are certainly included in that. But let's admit it, even the day-to-day stuff of family logistics, of general family life, I mean, it can be a really tough slog at times. That's just general. Forget the heavy duty trials, although that's part of it. Just general family life can be very difficult. Wiping faces, wiping tears, wiping runny noses, a few of us done that. Broken night's sleep, waking up, being woken up at 1 a.m., 3 a.m., 4 a.m., 4:27 a.m., and so on. Squabbling between siblings, cleaning up messes, breakfast on the table, breakfast on clean clothes, breakfast on the floor, putting on ointments, putting on band-aids, putting on bandages, making doctor's appointments, making specialist appointments, making A&E appointments. And sometimes that's just before morning tea. And so just the day-to-day stuff of life that we have to just go through, well, it can really hinder us sometimes. It's heavy, it can be weighty at times. But as believers, we need to understand that we're just simply not exempt from difficulty. And so what's important for us to understand is that it is important to prepare to persevere. That we prepare to continue to walk in God's wisdom, even, like we saw, even when it's hard to do so. Now, this is the encouragement that Timothy needed at the time that Paul was writing this letter of 2 Timothy. A massive outbreak of persecution had come against the church, and people were dying, people were imprisoned, Christians were getting a very hard time at the hand of Caesar Nero. And although Timothy had a desire to press forward in his God-given responsibilities, to press forward in the wisdom of God in these things, well, there were things that were happening all around him that posed a very real threat to be a very real potential to really hold him back from doing so, to force him to shrink back, to take the path of least resistance instead of pressing forward with the responsibilities that he had in front of him. Now, the way that Paul encourages Timothy to think, and the passage we're going to be looking at just in this very brief time now, in chapter 2, verses 3 to 6, well, he's encouraging Timothy to think differently, to think like a soldier, to think like an athlete, and to think like a farmer. This is the way that we need to think as we're going to see and look at, examine this passage a little bit more closely. And so let's just read the passage in our Bibles together. And as we read through these verses, I'm going to be extracting five observations, five principles that will help us as we seek to persevere in wisdom. When we leave from here and get into day-to-day life, whatever that's going to bring for us over the next day, week, month, year, some principles that we can come back to help us to press forward through those difficulties that are ahead. So let's read in our Bibles in 2 Timothy chapter 2, beginning in verse 3. It says, the Apostle Paul writes, you therefore must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. And also, if anyone competes in athletics, he is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. The hardworking farmer must be first to partake of the crops. Let's just pray. Father, keep us attentive. Speak to us as we just come to this home stretch now. Help to solidify and bring all these things together and to encourage our spirits for the onslaught that will come, that will try to hinder, that will try to take away from the goodness that's been shared and gleaned from over this weekend. We ask that you do it by your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. And so firstly, we see in verses 3 and 4 in our Bibles there, we see that in order to persevere, we need to be thinking like a soldier. Look in your Bibles there in verse 3 and what the Apostle Paul says. He says, you therefore must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Principle number one. If we want to persevere in God's wisdom through the trials of life, we need to firstly acknowledge that difficulty is part of the package. When a soldier is sent off to war, he's not surprised when hardship and when difficulty comes his way. Why not? Well, because he realizes that that's just part of the package. That's what he signed up for. And because he has this reality in the back of his mind of this is what I signed up for, he is able to then be freed up and actively engages himself in the war that's before him, knowing the opposition, knowing the battles which are to come his way. A good soldier doesn't run from the difficulties. If he runs from the difficulties, that's considered to be treason. But instead, he accepts that his temporary personal hardships are in fact working towards a greater good. And as to this end, he willingly continues to fulfill his duty. Friends, it is no different for us as we seek to persevere in the wisdom of God, while encouraging our children to do the same. Trials and difficulties are going to come our way. They shouldn't surprise us. We simply need to see these things as part of the package. We need to firstly see and expect that trials are going to come as the result of the fall. And so this is stuff such as sickness and disease and just sorrow and toiling to make ends meet, the struggles and the pressure that come as a result of sin and the entrance of sin into a fallen world of which we all live today. Secondly, we need to expect the trials that are going to come from the hand of others. Jesus himself said in John chapter 15, verse 18 and 19, he said, if the world hates you, know that it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love its own, yet because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. And in case we needed a little bit of clarification there, the Apostle Paul gives it to us in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 12. He says, yes, all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. And so what we need to understand here is that as we seek to center our lives and the lives of our family upon God's wisdom rather than man's wisdom, taking a stand and saying, I'm not going down the same track as everyone else around me, regardless of whether or not they profess to be a Christian, I'm taking a different path, I'm taking God's wisdom. We need to understand that it's not always going to be seen as the most popular thing to do. People are not going to go thumbs up when we seek to take God's wisdom over man's wisdom necessarily. If anything, as we look at the culture around us today, we see that there's actually a growing hostility toward it. Thirdly, we need to expect trials that come at the hand of Satan. From the fall, number one, from hand of others, number two, from Satan. Now listen to how the Apostle Peter puts it in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8. He says, "Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks around like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour." Now, we need to keep mindful that we have a real enemy, and that enemy hates us. That enemy hates our children. That enemy hates our families. And do you know what he especially hates? He especially hates the fact that you're here at this conference this weekend being encouraged to walk in the wisdom of God. As we're seeking to disciple our families, we need to understand that we are not doing so in a neutral environment. We're not doing so in an environment which is neutral to the cause. And so we shouldn't be ignorant of the fact that there is someone who is actively out there day or night, regardless of whether or not we're awake or asleep. He is awake and he is seeking to derail us. We have trials that come at the hand of Satan. And fourthly, we need to expect trials that are permitted by God. And so these are difficulties that are not necessarily originating or authored by God, but struggles that God allows for us to go through in order to keep us close and in order to keep us dependent upon him. The Apostle Paul writes about this in his own life in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 8 and 9. He says, "For we do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, of our trouble, which has came to us in Asia, that we were burdened beyond measure, above strength, so that we despaired even of life. Yes, we had the sentence of death in ourselves." Why, Paul? He tells us that we should not trust in ourselves, but in God who raises from the dead. And so what we're seeing here is that the call to live faithfully in the wisdom of God is not a call to ease or comfort, but it is a call to hardship. We will experience ongoing struggles. We will experience ongoing difficulties, and they're going to come our way for a whole number of reasons and from a whole lot of different sources. But thinking as a soldier, we can endure and persevere, reminding ourselves, hey, this is part of the package. God has warned us in his word. He's shown us in his word, this is what is to be expected. Now, parents, teaching your children this is essential to their discipleship. It is essential that we teach our children, look, this is part of the package. You follow in God's ways and it will be difficult. There will be difficulties that you need to go through while you still continue doing it as what it is that God wants you to do. But even more than teaching them, it's important that our children see us persevere through the trials and the difficulties that come our way. A lot of times we can think of all our trials and our difficulties about, you know, think of it in the way as, wow, this is God just wanting to work something out in my life. But don't forget how God can sovereignly use the same situation to be preparing our own very children through our example of faith and endurance. Now, look, I don't personally wish any hardship upon myself or for my family, but at the same time, I realize that if all my children experience in their upbringing, if all they see is a life of ease with just smooth sailing, it's not going to adequately prepare them for persevering as a soldier of Jesus Christ. We need to acknowledge that difficulty is part of the package. And so moving on from continuing with this illustration of the soldier, I want us to just notice now, what Paul says continuing on in verse 4. He says in verse 4, "No one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life." Now just stop there one moment while we draw a principle. Principle number 2. If we want to persevere in God's wisdom through the trials of life, we need to prioritize what we give our time to. When a soldier is on the front lines of battle, he must be very particular, he must be very single-minded in terms of what he gives his time to and what he gives his attention to. He cannot afford to primarily be focusing his time on things that are secondary in nature. There are lives at stake. And so he realizes the cost of losing focus on what it is that he needs to be focusing on, losing focus of what's really important. Now, here's the thing. Unless we have clearly defined between the good and the important, between the negotiables and the non-negotiables, between the things that are nice to do and the things that we must do, well, It will only make it that much harder to persevere when, not if, but when those seasons of difficulty will come our way. The trials that we experience are never easy, but sometimes, we experience a heightened degree of hardship during those times, but we do so because it's essentially self-inflicted. We've just spread ourselves too thin. We've unknowingly prioritized things of a temporal nature to the neglect of those things that are eternal in nature. It's not that our lives can't or shouldn't include both the temporal things in nature as well as the spiritual. It's not that the temporal things of the earth are wrong. It's just to say that we must prioritize between the good and the important, and the good and the important must be prioritized according to God's priority. Not to what we think is important, but what God's word says is important. So that when the trying seasons of difficulty come our way, again, which they will, when they come our way, we can know what we can afford to drop and what we can't afford to drop. Last term, our own family was feeling a little bit stretched, and just the, nothing major, but just the present season of life, family life, usual day-to-day things. And we were really feeling, me in particular, got a sense that we weren't fitting in all the things that are non-negotiable, things that God desires in our lives, in particular, evangelism. And so what we did is that we prayed for 2 or 3 weeks for wisdom. God, give us wisdom. What in our schedule are we not seeing? How can we fit? We want evangelism just to be a normal thing in our lives and a normal thing in our routine. But the only way, after praying and looking at our week and everything else, the only way it could happen was by having to cut out one of the children's weekly activities, which happened to be gymnastics. Now, listen to this. I don't have anything against gymnastics, you know. In fact, I think gymnastics is a really good thing to do if you want to do that. And in fact, we may intend to pick up that with the children at a future stage, Lord willing. But we realized if we were going to continue prioritizing the good, well, it was going to hinder us from giving our attention to the important. We had a decision to make. And our thinking went a little something like this. It says, well, when we're standing before God one day, which will happen, and when we're giving account for how it is that we use this season of family life, which are we going to be happy that we prioritize now, right now in this season of our family life? The good temporal activity or the important eternal activity? Not that it always has to be one or the other, but this is the way that we need to be thinking if we are going to make our priorities what God considers to be a priority. So that in fact, when we go through trials and when we go through difficulties that will come, the important things won't get pushed to the side, and instead we'll continue to walk in the wisdom of God. And to be honest, whenever we prioritize the important, our lives never feel as though they're lacking of something. It never feels as though we're missing. There was never once talk about gymnastics and us not attending the gymnastics on a weekly basis in our house. We must never think that prioritizing God's priorities is going to be, oh, now the family's strength. If anything, there's been a far greater richness, a far greater fulfillment, knowing that we are walking in the will of God and the whole family is right there and sees it as well. But notice in the rest of verse 4 that the reason why Paul encourages a single-mindedness in the way in which we use our time. He says it there in the rest of verse 4. He says, no one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. And so, point number 3 here. If we want to persevere in God's wisdom through the trials of life, we need to remember why we are doing what we are doing. See, when a soldier is on the battlefield, he knows the reason that he's there is simply because his superior has given him orders to follow through with. He's there to fulfill a responsibility that has been given to him by another. And when things get tough and everything in him feels like throwing in that towel and saying, I'm done, well, it all really comes down. The thing that keeps him on the battlefield, it all really comes down to pleasing the one whose authority he is under. Each one of us knows what it's like to feel as though we want to throw in the towel, you know, and what it is that we're doing in family life and what it is that we're doing in our lives, you know, and the important things in life. What on earth am I doing? We think to ourselves. Is it really worth it? I mean, when I'm honest, I feel underappreciated. I feel overworked. I don't even know how effective I'm being. In fact, when I'm really honest, I think it would be easier and even more enjoyable for myself if we were just doing things in a different way. But in the midst of those times, my wife and I have to take a step back, I know for sure, and we have to ask the question, why are we doing what we are doing? And the reason that so many people throw in the towel for the direction of walking ahead in God's wisdom is simply because they have lost sight of their why, as to why it is that they're doing what it is that they're doing. If our why is to, of what we are doing is to, is primarily based on the approval of others, or the thrill of the challenge, or I wanna try something new, even if our primary motivation is for the best of the children themselves, there is always gonna be reasons that we'll come up with to pull the plug when things get difficult. But when our primary reason for doing what we're doing is to please God, by acknowledging His authority, by seeking to walk in the direction that He has revealed for us in His word, that alone is the ultimate motivation that we've got to keep going and persevering in. We need to remember why it is that we're doing what we're doing. Husbands, remind your wife when she feels like throwing in the towel. Wives, remind your husband when he feels like calling time out. Children, you know, if both of your parents are feeling overwhelmed, don't say anything because you're probably part of the, probably part of the issue, but pray for them. You can pray for them and you know, and after they're cooled off, maybe towel them after that. But that's what it's going to keep us focused on the right thing. We need to think as a soldier, the apostle says here. And so moving on, thinking like a soldier, Paul talks about thinking like a competing athlete. Look at how he puts it there in verse 5. He says there in verse 5, and also if anyone competes in athletics, he is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. Principle number 4. If we want to persevere in God's wisdom through the trials of life, we need to keep in mind that God's way is the only way that leads to lasting reward. When an athlete is competing, he does not have the freedom to make up the rules as he's running the race. Hey, you know what? I think I'm going to make it this distance instead of that distance. Not at all. Yet as the athlete sees how much persistence that's needed, how much determination that's needed to be in the race, sometimes the athlete can be tempted to bypass the rules, to cheat. But if he's found cheating, what happens? He's immediately disqualified from any potential reward that's to come. Friends, in a similar way, how often do we start out well in the direction that God wants for us, but what we do is we hit a few bumps along the road and we begin to doubt whether or not God's way is actually going to work for us, and instead we look for doing things in alternative ways, things that are completely foreign to what it is that we see within God's word. That's not competing to the rules. It is not at our discretion to make up what we think is going to be best for us, given that God has already laid out all of His wisdom. He has laid out the rules, so to speak, within His word. If we want to persevere in God's wisdom, we can't afford to be short-sighted. We can't take a short-sighted approach because we'll begin with little compromises that will turn to bigger compromises. Instead, we need to look ahead to the crown. We need to look ahead at what's before of us. And of course, the crown is what? The crown are those words from Christ Himself. Well done, good and faithful servant. But can we expect to hear those words if we've chosen to not take God's wisdom, but instead to take our own? Listen to the Apostle Paul in Galatians 6:7. He says, "Let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart." Then in keeping with the theme of the athlete, don't we want the entrance that the Apostle Paul had? Listen to how he puts it in 2 Timothy 4:7 and 8. "I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. Finally, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day. And not me only, but all those who have loved His appearing." Look, friends, in the middle of those overwhelming difficulties, let's keep in mind that God's way is the only way that is going to lead to lasting rewards. Starting with a soldier, moving to an athlete, we're now encouraged finally to think like a farmer. It says in verse 6 there, "The hardworking farmer must first to partake of the crops." And so principle number 5, if we want to persevere in God's wisdom through the trials of life, we need to ensure that we are not only giving God's wisdom, but that we are also receiving God's wisdom. A farmer must hold back a portion of his crops to nourish himself physically before he's in a place to go and offer that physical food to others. If the farmer misses himself out of the crops, he's not going to be around for too much longer. In a similar way, If we're seeking to feed our families spiritually but not feeding ourselves in the same way, sooner or later, we're not going to be any good to anyone. The whole thing about persevering in wisdom really comes down to staying close to the one from whom wisdom comes. But before we can make disciples in our homes, we need to first be disciples in our homes. God doesn't promise that we'll be exempt from trials, but he does promise that he'll be with us through the trials. And so as we seek to stay close to him through the trials, we can have certainty of making it out the other end of those trials. Friends, I just want to wrap up really quickly by saying this, in closing and saying, when things get tough, when we're feeling weary, when we feel like withdrawing, when everything's around us and we think, oh, good, everything's around us, remember, think like a soldier, think like an athlete, think like a hard-working farmer. A soldier who stops fighting before the battle is finished will never see victory. An athlete who stops running before the race is over will never win the race. The farmer who stops working before the harvest is complete will never see the fruit of his crops. 5 things we can do. Acknowledge that difficulty is part of the package, number 1. Prioritize what we give our time to. Remember why we are doing what we are doing. Keep in mind that God's way is the only way that leads to lasting reward. Ensure that we are not only giving God's wisdom, but we are also receiving God's wisdom. And just to finish up the session on persevering through trials, I recall last year, this time exactly, to be honest, on the very final day of Engage, there was a young Christian family whom I know. They just found out that their 5-week-old daughter had just been diagnosed with type 1 SMA. SMA is a genetic neuromuscular disease through which the muscles of the body stop working progressively over a fairly short period of time, with the respiratory system being the last to be affected. And what happens, it results in death because of a lack of oxygen being able to get to the lungs. And I remember talking with the father on my hands-free phone, driving from the conference on that Saturday night last year, back out to my home, feeling absolutely devastated and heartbroken for them. And over those 5 weeks that followed, this family had to watch their precious little daughter deteriorate to the point in which she took her last breath. Is God's wisdom enough to get us through situations like these? Is it even possible to persevere in God's wisdom through these sorts of things? To answer that question, I'm going to leave that to the father himself. I'm just going to invite up now Kimball, who the father of that child is, and he's just going to explain to us what difference does God's wisdom make in a situation like that. It's Kimball.
Good afternoon. So a year ago, we were given the worst news that any parent could dream of, that our precious daughter, Myla Arbuthnot, would be taken away from us within months. She was diagnosed with SMA type 1. As Jason said, the genetic muscular disease, which is passed on to the child from both parents. Type 1 is the most severe, where 80% of infants pass away by the age of 1 year, and type 4 is the least severe, affecting adults. For each pregnancy, the child has a 25% chance of developing SMA. So our initial thoughts were that this can't be real. I mean, it always happens to other people, doesn't it? How do you prepare to deal with something that you only see happens on movies or TV? Well, we couldn't. Nothing could prepare us for this except one thing, and that is God's word planted deep in our hearts. What kept us going? It was knowing God through the entire counsel of his word. For me, God kept on reminding me of everything we had experienced, his faithfulness, everything we had read about God and his word. Leading up to that moment, every time I picked up the Bible and read his word, I got a more complete picture of who God is and his character, his justice, his mercy, his righteousness, his majesty, his perfect love. All of that truth came together in those moments. So our preparation from God, which was leading up to that moment, was every time we picked up the Bible and read God's word. The Word of God was our anchor in the middle of our worst storm in our lives. When the doubts and questions came, we would have given up all hope completely had it not been the truth about God, because God had securely established the knowledge of His character in our hearts and minds beforehand. Every time we got through the difficult times, God took us through four steps. And these steps went similar to this. Step number one, if God cannot lie, then His word is always true. And that was from Titus chapter 1, verse 2. Point number two, if God says He will never leave us nor forsake us, then He is with me right now and is sovereignly in control of everything in my life. And that was from Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5. If all things work together for the good of those who love Him, to those who are the called according to His purpose, then this was for our good. We were both called to this point in time together for a specific purpose. And as we know from Romans 8, chapter 8, verse 28. And the fourth point, if God is perfect, then everything He does is perfect and just. And that's from Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 4. So if there was ever any doubt about God's goodness, then He took us through the points 1 to 4 again, showing us that those doubts in our thoughts were wrong, showing us there just is no other valid option. God put boundaries in our hearts to guard our thoughts. As Hebrews chapter 10, verse 16 says, "This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws into their hearts, and in their minds I will write them." Had we rebelled or refused to listen to God's word, we would probably have fallen apart and not be a family anymore. But I don't think that was ever possible for us to rebel. God sovereignly protected us from rebellion by allowing us to be weak. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9 says, "God's strength is made perfect in our weakness." We were too weak to rebel, which caused us to fall into the comforting hands of our loving Savior. Amen.